What happens if you've got an Apple Silicon Mac and for whatever reason it's rendered completely unbootable? You need to perform the DFU restore operation. This screen of death links to articles that explain how to do that, and you may read there that you will need another Mac for the procedure. But as it turns out, it's not entirely true. Before we get to the details, let's start by explaining the problem a little bit, including what the DFU mode even is. If you already know that and just need the tutorial, you can skip some chapters in this video. If you've used any computer other than an Apple Silicon Mac and studied how it works at a low level, you are probably familiar with the concept of a firmware. Modern PCs and Intel Macs use UEFI, older PCs had BIOS, PowerPC Macs had open firmware, and so on. All those differ in the implementation, but the general idea is the same. There's a bit of flash memory on the motherboard that contains the first program that runs when you power up the machine. Its job is to initialize all the essential hardware, do some self-tests, often manage some essential hardware settings, and crucially, load the operating system's bootloader from mass storage and pass control to it. On most computers made since around the 80s, this firmware tends to have quite a lot of features, including the ability to load said bootloader from a wide variety of storage devices. So on most computers, if there's only a completely empty hard drive in it, you're expected to insert OS installation media, a scaled-down version of said OS will be loaded from that, and perform the final installation. Apple Silicon Macs are different. Their architecture is heavily based on that of the iPhone, and you can't boot an iPhone off a USB stick, can you? The internal firmware of Apple Silicon devices is very minimalist, and it only initializes the absolute essentials, then passing down control to code on the internal SSD. Much of the code that on a PC you'd find on the BIOS chip is stored on the main storage on M-series Macs. You can install macOS onto an external drive, but even then, loading it depends on a bootloader code that resides on the SSD. Apple software will try to prevent you from breaking that essential code. It's not obviously visible and it's locked when macOS is running normally. But sometimes you may need this. Typical cases in which you might end up not having a working bootloader on the SSD include data corruption due to hardware failures, data corruption due to a power outage while installing an OS, mistyped comments when doing power user stuff like custom Linux installs, homebrew SSD upgrades like on those videos where they do it through microsoldering, or just a desire for a completely clean reinstall. For cases like these, Apple provides a lifeline. That little bit of essential firmware stored on the Apple Silicon chip itself allows booting the machine into the device firmware update or DFU mode. In that mode, the processor waits for the recovery code to be provided through a USB port, but not in the form of a storage device, but from a second machine that will actively pump the necessary data. Software that implements this process has been available from Apple ever since the release of Apple Silicon Macs, but only for macOS. Initially, it was a feature of Apple Configurator, otherwise used for mass setup of iPhones and iPads in business settings, and later it was integrated into macOS itself. Thankfully, the open source community stepped in and re-implemented this process in a program called iDevice Restore. It can be built for just about any platform, but it's easiest to run it on Linux. One important side note though, if your Mac is enrolled in theft protection, either through iCloud and Find My Mac or an enterprise device management system, DFU Restore won't unlock it. You can wipe the SSD, but the restore process involves activating with Apple's servers, and if the serial number is locked to an online account, it'll ask you to log into it. To perform a DFU revive or restore operation from Linux, you will need a 64-bit x86 or ARM computer running modern Linux. Ubuntu 24.04 will be used in this tutorial. Anything capable of running it will be fine, desktop, laptop, even a Raspberry Pi. It's fine to run a live environment from a USB stick, although in that case you may need more RAM and double check your storage situation. It might also make more sense to use Fedora for that purpose, but more on that later. I also assume that you are comfortable using the terminal and the command line. This is an advanced procedure after all. Internet connection on said computer. Not just for downloading macOS, the DFU restore process includes authenticating the Mac being revived with Apple servers, so you will need internet connection during the process too. If your Mac has been locked to iCloud or Enterprise MDM, it will need to be connected to the internet after the restore as well for activation. Linux writable storage partition with about 20 GB of free space. Restore images for macOS Sequoia are over 16 GB after all. If you're using a machine that normally runs Windows, you should be able to utilize your Windows partition for storage. Although if it's encrypted, get your BitLocker recovery key ready and prepare for problems, just in case. A USB data cable. You'll need a Type-C connector on the revived Mac side. On the donor machine side, it can be Type-C or Type-A, whichever you have. The cable needs to support USB 2.0 data transfer. USB 3.0 might speed up the restore process, but it's not necessary. On your Linux machine, open a web browser and navigate to ipsw.me. You may think the website looks a bit shady, but it's just a repository for links pointing to Apple's servers, so feel free to verify that and don't worry. Select the model of your Mac, although the images are universal, so it shouldn't matter. Choose the latest version of macOS that your machine supports. Installing older versions may work, but it may also get blocked for security reasons. And download that. If your default download location doesn't have enough space, cancel the automatic download and use the Save Destination As option to navigate wherever you need. This download may take a while, so meanwhile let's prepare to run iDevice Restore. Navigate to your Downloads folder, that will make things easier, and open the terminal there. And here comes the weird part. iDevice Restore is actively developed, but hasn't seen a proper release for years. This also means that many distributions don't get versions that are new enough to support Mac Restore in their repositories. One distro that does include current versions of iDevice Restore and related packages is Fedora. And we can run it in a Docker container, so first of all we need to install Docker. And on Ubuntu that will be sudo apt-install-docker.io. When that finishes, we need a bit of magic. The full command is sudo docker run //net=host /v/dev/bus/usb:/dev/bus/usb /v/run:/run:/v.colon/mnt-ti:fedora:rawhide. Now that's a mouthful. Let's dissect what's going on here. Sudo docker run is of course the general command for running Docker containers. --rm causes the container to be removed after we exit it. We probably won't be running it again for a while, so that's a saner approach, probably. We need the processes running inside to have raw access to the USB bus. So that's what the next couple of arguments do. --privileged enables true root access inside. --net=host allows the container to access host sockets, which are used for hot plug events, and the -v arguments forward some important directories. Devbus USB for USB devices and run for the udev socket, which is used for hot plug. Finally, we share the current directory as /mnt so that we can access the downloaded image. -ti runs the container in interactive shell mode, and the image we were running is Fedora Rawhide, the development branch which has the most current packages. Now that we are in a Fedora container, let's actually install the programs we need. That will be DNF install, iDevice restore, USB maxd, USB utils. You may be wondering what USB maxd is. It's part of the same project that is necessary for communicating with the Mac. We also installed USB utils, which will make it easier to check if the Mac has been properly detected once we connect it. Now let's see if our download is finished. It looks like it is, so let's finally get on with this. For preparing the Mac, we can actually largely follow Apple's instructions. For me, the patient in question is a 2021 M1 Pro MacBook, so the DFU port is the one just next to MagSafe. By the way, using the original MagSafe charging cable is a good idea because it gives us an indicator light. One difference is that I won't be plugging the other end of the USB cable just yet. For some reason, my Linux machine only detects the Mac when it's plugged in after putting it in DFU mode. Now the keyboard acrobatics. The Mac boots to the exclamation point after opening the lid, so we first need to power it off by holding the power button. Note how the MagSafe LED turns off for a moment when that happens. Then get ready on the Control and Option keys on the left, and also Shift and Power on the right. One short press of the power, then 10 seconds on all the keys. If the MagSafe LED went off, it worked. We can now let go of the modifier keys and then the power button and connect the USB cable to the Linux machine. In the Docker container terminal, type lsusb to see the connected USB devices. We should see one that says Apple Inc. Mobile Device DFU mode. So now we're in business. First, we need to start the USB multiplexing daemon by typing usbmaxd-f-. -f makes it run in foreground mode and the ampersand puts it in the background. It may seem a bit contradictory, but it works around Docker weirdnesses and also lets us see some logs. Then type cd/mnt to enter the downloads directory, and finally idevice-restore, universal Mac, and the rest of the file name depending on the macOS version you downloaded, or realistically speaking press tab to complete it. This command will perform the operation that Apple calls revive. You may also specify the -e option to do the restore, i.e. full wipe. That will remove all data from your Mac, so don't use it if you're not entirely sure about what you're doing. The revive operation should be non-destructive, but we are still performing a low-level operation, so be careful. If your computer still boots and you don't have a backup, you probably want to make one first. So, this is it. This is the H hour. You press enter and the magic happens. In case of the full wipe, you'll also need to specifically confirm that you acknowledge the data loss by spelling out yes on the terminal. You'll get a lot of log messages on the Linux machine, and if everything goes well, the Mac should show the Apple logo, then a progress bar, and after a couple of minutes, boot into either the recovery activation screen or the setup assistant. If the process hangs on waiting for device to enter restore mode, make sure that you run usbmaxd before idevice restore. If you're sure that you do, or if you're getting other errors, make sure that you're using recent versions of usbmaxd and idevice restore. 2024 releases are okay, but earlier versions may not work properly. If your restore process fails early, you may also try using a different USB port on your Linux machine. On one of my computers, connecting the Mac to a USB 3.0 port instead of a 2.0 one solved the problem I was having, even though I was using a 2.0 cable. Switching ports never hurts. You may also see an error early in the process that says device did not disconnect and unable to place device into recovery mode. That probably means that the USB hot plug events are not received properly by the program. Check that the /run directory is forwarded and that the --net equals host option is specified on the Docker command line. Anyway, that's it. You can disconnect the USB cable, close everything on the Linux machine, and enjoy your restored Mac.